My name is Albert Polman. I work at AMOLF. AMOLF is one of the NWO institutes in Amsterdam. And it's my honor to introduce Margaret Murnane as the last speaker here today. She is a fellow and professor at the University of Colorado in Boulder. And she's running an amazing laboratory in optical sciences, X-ray sciences, ultra-fast optical phenomena, with applications in physics, chemistry, biology, engineering. We're going to hear all about that today. Margaret was born in Ireland, went to the University of Cork there, and then moved to the University of California in Berkeley for a PhD, and now in Boulder, Colorado, a member of many professional societies, winner of many different awards, honorary doctorates from many different universities. So Margaret, we're really honored to have you as our speaker here, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Albert. I'm delighted to be here to tell you about our work on tabletop X-ray lasers, and I'll try to tell you a story about the evolution of this field, which started with research that was funded by the Star Wars Initiative, for those of you distinguished and senior enough to remember the Ronald Reagan era in the US. And then if I accomplish my task, I would like to explain to you how we are much better off understanding quantum physics, and fundamentally it is much more powerful than any nuclear weapon or Star Wars era technology. And I also want to acknowledge the work that I'm going to talk about was done in collaboration with my long-term collaborator and husband, Henry Kaptein, who has, of course, very strong connections here to the Netherlands. So I'd like to start with talking about light. Most of us understand our world and make sense of the world using light, using our eyes. And you could make a good argument that our modern understanding of nature began when Maxwell wrote down the beautiful Maxwell's equations that describe the wave nature of light. And of course, Maxwell was brilliant, but he didn't get everything right. There is a quote here from one of his comments: in a few years, all great physical constants will have been approximately estimated, and the only occupation which will be left to men of science will be to carry these measurements to another place of decimals. And thank goodness Maxwell was not right about this, or we wouldn't all be here. And also, of course, completely unaware that within very soon we would use light and the photo effect and the discrete nature of atomic emission lines to realize that we live in a quantum world. And so it was really modern physics is based on our understanding of the quantum nature of light. And there's a beautiful reciprocity now that it turns out that laser-driven quantum effects in atoms are allowing us actually to get full control over light. So as many things in physics, we have an exchange of ideas back and forth, an exchange of capabilities. So we've understood how to control light in the visible region of the spectrum to an exquisite extent for over 55 years now. 2010 was the 50th anniversary of the laser. And this technology started out as a solution looking for a problem. They had no idea that the ability to create a directed beam of light would totally transform our economy with the internet, science, surgery, ranging, many, many, many applications. But those of you in the field may not realize that in that 55 years, the laser technology that's in widespread use has decreased in wavelength from the initial red light of the first ruby laser that Ted Maimon demonstrated to only the ultraviolet region of the spectrum. 193 nanometers that's accessible using excimer laser technology. So it's actually remarkable how slow the progress has been. In most other areas of science, we have orders of magnitude increase in capabilities in computing, data storage, and other areas. But in light, we've really managed to decrease laser light only by a factor of four. Now, there are shorter wavelength lasers in existence, but they are very challenging to implement, and as a result, they really haven't found any widespread application. Now, of course, there is X-ray technology that you meet very often in security, in your doctor's and dentist's office. But interestingly, that X-ray tube technology is basically a more powerful version of the first X-ray tube that Röntgen demonstrated way back in 1895. And in some cases, when your radiologist looks at the X-ray that is taken, it isn't a whole lot better than that first X-ray that Röntgen took of his wife's hand. And you might ask, so why? Well, one of the reasons why is you're essentially taking a picture using an X-ray light bulb. You could do so much better if you had a directed beam of X-rays. So why not build an X-ray laser? It turns out that it's energetically almost impossible. And the reason why is, if you want to make an X-ray laser, you need to put atoms in a highly excited state. They decay very quickly if they're in a highly excited state, and you need to make a population inversion. So the power you need to power an X-ray laser goes as the wavelength of that laser to the inverse fifth power. That doesn't seem too bad initially until you throw a few numbers in, and what you'll quickly find is that I can hold a green laser pointer in my hand because I only need a milliwatt to power it. But if I want to make a laser that lasers at 1 nanometer, it takes a terawatt of power. That's about the electrical generating capacity of the United States. So you are not going to make an X-ray laser that's powered continuously. It's just that energy does not exist. And if you want to make a 1 angstrom X-ray laser, you would need a petawatt of power. And it's for exactly this reason that in the 1980s, during the Star Wars era, there were proposals to make X-ray lasers that could shoot down missiles by detonating nuclear weapons in space. But fortunately, that was not implemented in a widespread way. And it's exactly this power scaling is why that the first coherent X-ray beams were not based on a population inversion or laser technology, but were rather based on electron acceleration. And what's shown here is a picture of the electron accelerator that powered the X-ray free electron laser that was demonstrated at Stanford just about on the 50th anniversary of the laser. Steve Chu was Secretary of Energy, as it happened, in the United States at the time. And so Steve, of course, has a great wit. And what he said is, it's a marvelous machine, can make a millijoule of X-ray pulses every 100 hertz, but it's certainly not free, and I should know it, because the price tag on these lasers are on order of $1 to $2 billion. So they're amazing machines, and amazing science is coming out. Just we heard about the beautiful science from LIGO yesterday evening. But if we want to have a widespread application in medicine or in industry, we need to look at other paths. And that's what I'd like to talk about, that it turns out that quantum mechanics has given us a route where we can make short wavelength light that's coherent or laser-like, that goes all the way from the ultraviolet into the soft X-ray region of the spectrum, and we don't understand where the limits are as yet. And in fact, as an old plasma physicist, the degree to which we can control X-ray light is actually quite astounding and something that none of us ever expected. I can claim that we can control light now in the X-ray region, actually in some cases more precisely than we can do in the visible region of the spectrum. And the reason is just from the quantum physics that actually what we do is we can take an atom that is radiating and control the radiating electron wave function. And that allows us to sculpt the X-ray light in ways using visible light. So for those of you who use X-rays, you will know that we have very poor X-ray optics. So things that are standard in the visible, like wave plates or polarizers or mirrors or focusing optics, lenses, things like that, we don't have those in the X-ray region. But what quantum physics has allowed us to do is actually control the X-ray light using visible light, where we have an array of optics that we can use. So we can actually make an X-ray supercontinuum, not with one octave of bandwidth, as in frequency combs, but actually with 12 octaves of coherent bandwidth that go all the way from the ultraviolet to the soft X-ray region. We can decide if the light emerges as a supercontinuum or as a peak. We can control its polarization, control the spatial coherence. So, in other words, we can now control light in the X-ray region using visible light. So how do we do that? So we take nonlinear optics, which was first demonstrated only a year after the laser was demonstrated. So in 1961, Peter Franken took the newly invented ruby laser and focused it into a quartz crystal. And that was the first time anybody had changed the color of laser light from one color to another. They didn't know how to do it very efficiently. So when Franken submitted a picture of their photographic plate to Physical Review for publication, the typesetter thought that the little speck was a speck of dust, and so whited it out. So if you look on this publication back from 61, for the evidence of second harmonic generation, there's absolutely no evidence in the paper. But they never did an erratum. Because anybody with a ruby laser, you could focus it on any surface and you'd make surface second harmonic generation. So everybody believed the result. So what's going on? So what we're doing in nonlinear optics is driving the electron with a light field sinusoidally. But if the electron is in an anisotropic crystal, its motion can be anharmonic. If the motion is anharmonic, then we're going to get not only the fundamental frequency radiated, but also harmonics of the fundamental laser. And you can push that a little bit and maybe get the third and the fifth. If you're lucky, the seventh. If you're really lucky, the ninth harmonic. And so it was for about 30 years. So question is, how could you go further? If you just turned up the laser power, you would burn your crystal. So to make an analogy with sound, if you pluck a string gently, you'll get the fundamental tone. If you pluck very hard, you'll get high harmonics. And if you could figure out how to pluck really, really hard, you might be able to get very high harmonics, but you have to do that before you destroy the medium. And it turns out the way to do that is to use a really short light pulse. And that essentially can pluck the electron wave function in an atom really hard to make the atom emit very high harmonics before you blow the system up. So we use titanium sapphire lasers, which make it very, very easy to make a really short burst of light with systems that even a high school student can operate. And so using a somewhat similar laser, Charlie Rhodes, way back in 87, made a fundamental discovery. If he took a short burst of light, this time in the ultraviolet, and focused it into a gas, he saw not only the fifth and seventh and ninth harmonics, but the 17th harmonic of the fundamental laser. And very soon afterwards, people saw even up to the 100th harmonic. And when they saw the spectrum, people knew immediately there was something different going on, because instead of a diminishing return where every harmonic is weaker and weaker, they saw a whole range of harmonics that were all equally bright. So people knew there was something different about the physics. People started asking how they're emitted. Interestingly, this research was funded by the Strategic Defense Initiative, which was Star Wars. But the funding agencies told Charlie Rhodes there can't be anything new going on, so forget about that. And it turns out that it was one of the last or the most recent fundamental thing we learned about the hydrogen atom, and it turns out it's true for any atom or molecule one places in a laser field. If you turn up the intensity so that the laser field is on order of the field that binds the electron to the atom, all atoms of molecule exhibit this fundamental response where in the electric field of the laser, one depresses the Coulomb barrier, part of the wave function of the electron will tunnel ionize, move away from the laser under the action of the light field, and this wriggle energy of motion that you can just calculate from Newton's second law, if the electron returns, that can get coherently converted into an X-ray. And this ionization happens on every half cycle of the laser, and that means you get a periodic emission in time, which if you take a Fourier transform, you will also get a periodic emission in frequency, and this is the origin of these high-order harmonics with an amazing scaling law. So now, instead of the wavelength to the inverse fifth power that dictates if you make a laser, now you have a scaling that goes quadratically with the laser wavelength. Just quite amazing. Of course, we know an electron is not a point particle, and this is what's actually happening to the atoms. You can think about this as starting out with the hydrogen atom in the ground state, and then this is the what happens to the electron wave function when you irradiate with a strong laser field. The interference between the wave packet that was in the continuum rescattering off the core gives this beautifully spatially modulated wave function. That effectively means that the time-dependent dipole moment is very rapidly changing on timescales much faster than the driving laser frequency. And essentially, you can just calculate the acceleration and then from that calculate the radiated field. And this is the microscopic origin of these high-order harmonics. Essentially, what we have is a nanoscale quantum antenna that we can, where we can control these interferences and control the X-ray light that's emitted. And essentially what we have is a coherent version of the Röntgen X-ray tube. If you think about what would you do to the Röntgen X-ray tube to make the light that was emitted coherent and laser-like. So what you would have to do is try to make the filament coherent in some way, and that's the same as starting with an atom in the ground quantum state, for example, of hydrogen. Then you would need to accelerate electrons in a coherent field, and that is essentially what this process does by using a laser field to accelerate the electron. And then you would need to have those electrons re-encounter a coherent quantum state. And in high harmonic generation, that's happening because the part of the wave function in the continuum is colliding making a transition to the ground state of the atom. And so every state is quantum coherent, and that's how we can make a coherent version of the X-ray tube. Now, everything I've told you has been known for 20 years or more. It's really, the quantum physics were written down in 1992, but it took us a long time to make a light source out of it because of something that at first glance might seem very trivial for optical scientists, which is that if you look at the laser field shown in red here irradiating an atom, and harmonics are emitted shown here in blue while the atom is ionizing, but they correspond to an electron making a transition from a continuum state to the ground state, and it's a dipole transition. So the radiation that's emitted will have a characteristic dipole pattern. It won't be a beam. If you want a beam, what you have to do is force many atoms in the medium to radiate so that the X-rays all synchronize so that their crests interfere constructively in the forward direction, and then you get a beam. How hard could that be? Well, okay, so, but we know that light of different colors are bent different amounts by prisms, for example. So normally, light of different colors will travel at different speeds. So it's actually quite hard to do the following, to make an X-ray and then have both the X-ray light and the laser light travel at the same speed so that the X-rays from different positions in the media interfere constructively. And I'll use an orchestra analogy like we heard last night. So here the analogy is to imagine that the infrared laser is a quantum conductor conducting the same number of atoms in the medium as there are people on planet Earth. And what you're trying to do is to get everybody to sing in tune at the same time, because it's about that many atoms that you need to force to radiate constructively. The reason it's hard is that this little cartoon is not drawn to scale. Your laser light has a wavelength of, say, 4 microns, but your X-ray light has a wavelength of a nanometer or less, and you have to synchronize the peaks of the X-rays to a much smaller fraction of their wavelength. So you have to synchronize the X-ray fields with sub-angstrom spatial resolution and sub-attosecond temporal resolution. And we don't have electronics that can allow us to do this. So you have to figure out the quantum mechanics, and then nature has to help you, but it actually works. One reason it works is the quantum physics of tunneling. Tunneling is exponential in the field. It actually scales as the laser intensity to the 11th power. So that means all the quantum tunneling happens at the peak of the field. The electron returns in a very deterministic trajectory. And so that's why the synchronization works so perfectly. So essentially what happens is on the leading edge of the laser pulse, the laser light is propagating a neutral gas. That's like glass. It slows down the phase velocity of the laser. The X-rays, as usual, will just pass straight through everything. Nothing bends them. So they're always traveling with the phase velocity given by the speed of light in vacuum. So on the leading edge, the laser light is traveling too slow. On the trailing edge, after you've ionized the medium, the laser light phase velocity is greater than C. But for some fraction of the laser pulse, the laser light will travel at a phase velocity equal to that of the X-rays. And in that interval, which we call a phase matching window, you get constructive interference of any X-rays that are generated during that time. And we can control the width of that window so that we get a single burst of X-rays or many bursts of X-rays. And essentially, that's the mechanism, is very fine control of quantum tunneling and electron wave packet recollision. So we can sort of draw that what looks like a very simplistic scaling graph. There's a huge amount of quantum physics underlying this, where if we use different color driving laser wavelengths from the visible through the near-infrared and the mid-infrared, that then the solid lines are our theory and the dots are where we validated this understanding experimentally. So if we want light in the vacuum ultraviolet, we can use visible femtosecond lasers. But if we want light in the extreme ultraviolet or soft X-ray region of the spectrum, we have to use near and mid-infrared lasers in order to do that. So our setup looks like the following. We put very high pressure gas inside a waveguide, and then focus in laser light of different colors from the ultraviolet to the mid-infrared, and then we get out X-ray beams that are perfectly spatially and temporally coherent from the extreme ultraviolet now into the soft X-ray region of the spectrum, where at this peak where we've accessed this experimentally to date at just about 1.6 keV, this corresponds to a 5,000th order nonlinear process that's also phase matched. So to our knowledge, this is the highest order nonlinear process that anybody has been able to observe, with a 12-octave bandwidth and ridiculously short pulses. This this bandwidth is sufficient for a 2 attosecond pulse. We don't know anything we need to measure, but that happens that quickly. But the fact that we can have coherence over that broad a bandwidth is very interesting for correlated physics of and we can arrange, as I said before, if we can make a delta function in frequency or a delta function in time. They're related by Fourier transform. So if we make a very short pulse of burst of X-rays, we'll have a huge supercontinuum. If we make a pulse train, we'll get a frequency comb. And we can control all of that now by just controlling the quantum physics. We can also do things that we didn't think were possible before, such as manipulating the polarization of the X-ray light. This is the movie I showed you before of our strong field laser-driven ionization. If we drive an atom with a circularly polarized laser, then the electric field of the laser just rotates. In that case, we certainly ionize the atom, and just waiting for the movie to catch up here. So the atom ionizes, but if you notice, the electron wave function just gets driven by the rotating field of the laser, and it never re-encounters the ion, so you don't get any harmonics, because there's no dipole transition back to the ground state. And because of that, for 20 years, people thought there was no way to make circularly polarized harmonics. However, Wilhelm Becker's group had done two beautiful papers that had a total of about 2 sites, back in the this is theorist, back in 1995, and he had come up with a solution, which is drive the atom with counter-rotating circularly polarized light, and if you do that, you can get the best of both worlds. Essentially, you can ionize the atom, but in that combined field, the electrons actually do recombine. If you have a recombination event, you can make harmonics. And essentially, what this looks like are we have 2 counter-rotating lasers. Their combined field has this beautiful threefold symmetric, which has just got to do with the ratio of the 2 wavelengths. Because of this shape, the electron, when it ionizes, can also return to the core. The beautiful thing about it is that because we can only take away in our high harmonic photon has to conserve energy and photon spin angular momentum. Conservation of energy means I just need to take a certain number of red photons and blue photons and I get my high harmonic photon. But because I can only take 1 unit of photon spin angular momentum, I can only grab 1 more red or blue photon than the other, and that forces the emission of circularly polarized harmonics. So every 3rd harmonic is left circularly polarized, the harmonic adjacent to it is right circularly polarized, and the harmonic adjacent to it is missing. It just doesn't conserve photon spin angular momentum. So now we have a way of tailoring the polarization, doing X-ray magnetic circular dichroism, and if we actually cross the beams, we can actually force different harmonics to go in different angles, so we don't need a spectrometer to separate the harmonics of different colors. And we can make truly crazy light fields. This is an example of these circularly polarized harmonics. This is theory, and this is an experimental measurement of how the direction of the field and the frequency and the color of these light fields are all changing on a sub-femtosecond time, and we can actually measure that. And we think this is one of the most complex coherent light fields that has been demonstrated to date. So in the last 10 minutes or so of my talk, that about right, Albert? Thank you. I'd like to just give you one application. Using these light sources, we now have essentially a tabletop synchrotron that's exquisitely coherent, both spatially and temporally. If I had time, I would give you an example of both, but I'll be able to give you an example of one. But one thing I must say, it's because these light sources are so different and so precise that in any application we've looked at, whether it's in magnetic materials or charge transfer materials or nanoscale mechanical properties or looking at correlated materials, that in every case we learned something new about the material because we had a very unique light source with unique characteristics that we could look at these materials with. So let me give you an example of harnessing the spatial coherence of these light sources. And the reason why it's interesting is that X-ray imaging always has had potential for super, to very precise imaging. But to make a very good image, you do need a lens. And since its inception, X-ray imaging has been limited by the fact that, of course, you don't have a refractive optic in the X-ray region. You have to use a diffractive optic. So people use something called zone plates. But the spatial resolution of these zone plates is completely limited by one's ability to fabricate the outer zone very, very precisely. So independent of what wavelength you have available, it turns out the best X-ray microscope was demonstrated at Berkeley. It had a spatial resolution of 13 nanometers, but that was using a 2-nanometer X-ray wavelength. So it was 6 times diffraction limited. And most ordinary people could make a microscope that maybe had 25 or 50 nanometer spatial resolution, nowhere near the wavelength limit. Fortunately, way back in 1952, David Sayer proposed that if you had a laser-like beam, you could do better. So what you would do is shine your laser on a sample, pretend it's a cell or a nanoparticle, and then collect the scatter pattern. Now, in a normal microscope, you'd put a lens in to take the Fourier transform of that scatter pattern and recover the image. But if you had a constraint, for example, if the sample was isolated, then Sayer proposed use an algorithm to guess the phases and then reconstruct the image. And John Miao was the first person to do this in 2D about 50 years after Sayer had proposed this. And Sayer is also a co-author on John's paper. So the wonderful thing about it is no lenses, no aberrations. So one can reach diffraction limited resolution. It's a phase and amplitude contrast imaging, very robust to vibrations. You don't need to stabilize, and it's the most photon efficient form of imaging. And the little cartoon of the phase retrieval algorithm is shown here. The idea is you take your scatter pattern and you assign random phases. You get your image. You know the sample was isolated, so this part here is due to an incorrect guess of the phase. So you can set those amplitudes to zero, take another Fourier transform, replace the theoretical amplitudes with the experimental amplitudes, and go around the loop, and hopefully you get the right image. Eat your heart out. This is the full, this is David Sayer's entire paper. I guess I'll have to read you this last sentence, which none of us would get away with getting published these days, but that last sentence is, the extension to 3 dimensions is obvious. It was not. And for ages, so the technique was there. People had done demonstrations. But because isolation is not a very strong constraint, what the trick people would play is that they would do about 200 different phase retrievals, and they would average all the objects. And then they would present an average of your sample to the person who wanted to know what his sample looked like, and that did not go down very well. Because people wanted to know what their sample was, not an average image of their sample. But through advances in algorithms, that has changed now. So essentially, a small change, it might at first appear like a small change, but it's not. The idea is now take overlapping images with 80% overlap, and now tell the algorithm you have to come up with a beam, an illumination, and a sample that's consistent with an overly redundant data set. And that is very, very powerful. So you don't have to do sort of an averaging anymore. So essentially what you do is you scan your beam with lots of overlap, and it turns out the algorithm has no choice but to converge very efficiently, and it works. if we combine that with advances in the light source technology, we can now take images where our phase image of nanostructures on a silicon wafer is actually higher contrast now than an SEM. So this the amplitude image is, you can think about it a little bit like an atomic force microscope, and the phase image is sort of like, the phase image is like an atomic force microscope, and the amplitude image is like a scanning electron microscope. And works very well. We can make height maps, amplitude maps. We can image beneath metallic overlayers. In this case, the visible microscope would only see the metal, whereas our amplitude contrast can see a buried interface and actually can see that there was diffusion happening at the buried interface. This particular image here is the first sub-wavelength X-ray image using any light source, facility scale, or small scale. Essentially, the contrast is flipped here, but this is a scanning electron microscope image of a periodic sample. Periodic samples are hard for phase retrieval algorithms because the scatter pattern has very strong peaks at the periodicity. So if you can make a periodic sample image, you can make any image. And what this shows, this is a 13.5 nanometer microscope of interest for lithography with 12.5 nanometer spatial resolution. And because we have a phase and amplitude image, you get this nice height reconstruction as well as the amplitude image. So just in the last 3 years or so, we've gone from essentially toy samples where we could image holes poked in a membrane to now where we can make, you know, real maps, height maps, buried interface maps, and get record spatial resolution. And this is the best image, this is the best zone plate microscope image ever taken. At 13 nanometers, it would have 15 nanometer spatial resolution, or at 2 nanometers would have 12 nanometer, a 2 nanometer illumination wavelength would have 12 nanometer spatial resolution. So 6 times diffraction limited, unlike the sub-wavelength imaging that's now possible. So let me go to my last few view graphs. Do a quick... that we can now, what I won't have time to show you is we can now look at sub-femtosecond electron scattering and screening in materials, but that'll be the subject of a different talk at a different conference. But just to let you know that because we're learning how to make brighter beams at shorter and shorter wavelengths, the results that I've shown are in nowhere near the limit, and as we go to the illumination beams in the around 1 nanometer, we'll be increasing the spatial resolution of these microscopes while also combining dynamic imaging and a whole new generation of fiber laser technology is making this harmonic technology more accessible. So we didn't need a nuclear weapon. We just figured out how to harness quantum physics. That has allowed us to have to really master light in a unique way in the X-ray region of the spectrum. Because there is no way still to combine time-dependent Schrodinger equation with Maxwell's equation, we don't know where the limit of this technology is. To try to predict those limits, you would have to combine 3D quantum diffusion with Maxwell propagator for many, many millions of atoms, and that's just not theoretically tractable yet, which makes it a very interesting area of physics because we have to make baby steps experimentally and then approximations theoretically so we can try to predict where we can go. It's as we heard in many of the talks, sometimes progress in science can take a long time. With MRIs, it took 50 years to get the technology in widespread use, and we're sort of in that same situation with high harmonic generation. And so with that, I'd like to thank you very much for your attention and thank my collaborators.